greeters, and this is sort of the guaranteed that pass along as a guest. The folks who are looking at the newcomers coming through the door, we had a couple of them down the show.
Four.
This is all good news, but these are all people who don't know, they don't have comments. So what kind of specific behaviors should cause us to at least take a second look at somebody rather than just kind of accepting them, welcoming them, and steering them into the church?
Certainly. So that's an excellent question, and it's a little bit of a complex one, because there's really no black or white answer. It's going to be it's going to be a gut feeling. It's going to be an on-the-spot decision that you're going to have to make, and it could be any one of you. This could be, and it does, you know, take yourself out of the mindset that this can only happen here. This can happen in any part of your life. You could be at Costco, the Ross Park Mall, Target. You could be at a game. It doesn't matter. This could happen anywhere, you know. So anything we're discussing has application in many different venues. So as far as identifying behavior with somebody approaching the building, what we're going to be looking for is somebody who is more than likely erratic, okay? Somebody who's avoiding eye contact largely. Somebody who may or may not have a weapon. Can you see a weapon? Obviously, that's an easy one because we know we need to take immediate action. But if it's not quite that easy, then you're going to have to address, you know, what you're observing. Specifically, if somebody's gathering intelligence, they'll be asking questions. Questions about, if you don't know somebody, you're not familiar with somebody, and they're asking questions about what's your busiest service, that's actually something you want to contact law enforcement about and get us involved. Hey, we had somebody that came by here. We've never seen them before. They were asking us, when's your busiest service? How many people? Do you lock the doors? Are all your doors open? Do you keep your doors open? Those are the types of things that really should set off flags, and I would expect that you call us immediately. Now, you can really help us out when you get people like that if you can get their license plate, a good physical description of what they look like, their plate, make and model of the vehicle, which direction did they leave here, etc. We have cameras all over Franklin Park, especially at the intersections. So we're able to track people very well that are, you know, coming in and breaking into houses, cars, etc. We're able to track them throughout the area. So that information is critical so that we can then engage. So you need to help us, and that's important. Let me give you an example of something that occurred at Saints John and Paul, and they didn't know what to do. During a service, they had somebody who came up to the altar and actually started screaming at the priest who was at the time giving out communion. And so he started going off on this rant. It was just craziness. But everybody froze and they didn't know what to do. And they were like, well, Jason, what should we have done? What do we do in that situation? You know, that is a very likely situation that could happen and could either escalate into something very bad quickly or that may need dealt with at that point. So I'll stop there and say, what would you do? If that occurred here, somebody came up, somebody that you're not necessarily familiar with, and they started screaming craziness, how would you handle that? Who would handle that?
My guess is that if Regis couldn't handle it, there would be people who would
Okay.
That there would be people who would come up and offer to assist or help proceed just so that he wasn't there by himself.
Okay.
I think from my point of view, the simple answer is that the people who have to be the responders from the congregation are the stewards, right? So we've got the
priest.
Well, I know, not the steward on duty, all right? But as I said, the fact that you're not a steward on duty doesn't mean that if something happens in the church, you are not still a steward. So I would expect stewards and or ushers to be the ones who come in. We don't want lots of people coming forward. We want people coming forward to have the kind of opportunity to think this through a little bit.
There are people in the community currently that we are aware of that could perform in that fashion, or that could show up at any one of our places of worship here in Franklin Park. They're out there, and we know who they are. So don't be surprised if you ever find yourself in that situation. And like I said, that situation could stop at just yelling, or they could produce a knife, or worse, a gun. Then what do we do? How do we handle that, right? So you wanted practical application. These are things that have occurred here in Franklin Park. So I would like to present them for you to think about and continue the conversation within the security group moving forward. Back to, you know, the exterior scenario. Go ahead.
What did they do?
They sent ushers up to, so the priest retreated back. The ushers came up, and there was an off-duty law enforcement officer who came up and assisted as well. And then he was escorted. He was resistant to being escorted out. But once the large number of people started coming together, he still made his statement and was running his mouth, but did leave. And obviously, people were calling 911. And so we eventually got there. But numbers matter. Okay, when you're dealing with irate people or people that want to harm people, when they see a response of a large number, it's just like anything else. I mean, that's creating that fear factor, like, well, now I have four or five people who are approaching me all around me. I'm in a bad situation. So that's something to think about as far as how we would approach that. Yeah.
So you mentioned stop the bleed training as a kind of training and first aid training.
Yes.
For those of you who don't know, the diocese is planning to stop the bleed training day in January. Guess who's running it? But those will go out and we can send a group or send lots of people. It's going to be wide open. And so that training is handled. But there's a different kind of training, which is de-escalation training.
Right? Okay, yeah.
Have two people in the congregation get into it with one another, or husband and wife, or whatever.
Yes.
Is there any kind of training offered that you know of to talk people down and just get to the...
So, I'm I was certified in verbal judo. I don't know if you've ever heard that. Verbal judo, you should look it up. It was developed by an educational PhD. He was a police officer and a college professor, and he developed this de-escalation school. It's very efficient, and I was certified in it. I still have all my material. My certification has long passed, but that's something that I can still teach, and it's very good. I use it on the street all the time. I have talked down many violent people without having to lay a finger on them by using some of the techniques that were taught. So I would be happy to maybe discuss that.
Okay.
And provide that training. But the book is out there, Verbal Judo. You could look it up, and if you know someone here, any of you read the book, you could probably do a train the trainer just from reading the book. All the five, it's called the five-step hard style. You go through this five-step process. All the information's in there.
Okay.
Yeah.
Now the other topic that I have an interest in is this issue of calling the police.
Okay.
Right? Both how to make a 911 call that is quick but gives the dispatcher what the dispatcher needs, and how do we call for non-emergency areas of concern. And I was explaining to somebody during the break. You know, if we see someone and it just looks like it might get a little hairy, how do we call you guys without getting 10 cars and a SWAT team?
So, good question. When you call 911, the dispatchers are going to guide you through the conversation. So they're largely going to dictate what information. Even if you try to overpower them, they're going to readjust you and direct you to the information that they need first. So where you can help is by having very good information to give them when requested. So descriptions of people, directions of travel, things like that. So the more information that you have available, the better. As far as calling 911, you can call 911 and not get a SWAT response, etc. You just tell them what's going on. Hey, we have a suspicious person. We'd like someone to come over and check it out. I would discourage you to call like the landline for the police department because we're not always there. We're a smaller department, so we don't have 24-hour coverage on our landlines. So you should always call 911 if you want us to come. That would be my 2 cents on that. Yeah.
Any other thoughts? Any other questions?
Yes, that's a good question.
Okay.
So, retired military, retired teacher, and one of the things that I don't quite understand is when we practiced a couple weeks ago, I was the air horn dude.
Okay, yeah.
Which I guess I didn't do well enough. First time I heard that in public. Seeing about 60 to 100 people of varying degrees of mobility trying to lead away from the front of the building to go through kind of a small area and get to the back and get outside, I understand that moving away from the threat. But when we get to the back part of our church, or the church grounds, we're stuck. We don't have steps to get us to continue away from the threat. So the reason why I brought up the target feature is so many schools that are trying to make the target harder, or harder, I should say, and going to the mousetrap kind of entry into schools to keep the threat from getting it. To me, when I look at our church, that space seems like it'd be much easier to harden it and much quicker to close doors if we do have a threat that's coming from the outside. There are, I think, 2 or 4 doors that we could harden and be a lot safer to create more time, maybe combined with a different type of mousetrap entryway. So I was going to pose that to you as far as it seems like that is safer given our context of us trying to leave our building and where we end up, we're kind of stuck.
Uh-huh.
There's snow, this grassy hillside outside is wet, people are going to be able to move. So I just want to know what you thought about that.
Well, it's a great question, and I'll tell you what most people would tell you. Well, it just depends. I can't really answer that, it depends.
Sure.
But I have a different answer. And it goes back to my combat skills training. If you want to get an answer, the best way to do is train. You have to train it, right? And evaluate the outcome. That's what training's all about. So, what I would want to do to give us the best answer for that is if we do the drills, or if I can come over on a day and we can actually drill that. So if I could take this group and we go in there, we put our systems in place, our radios, our alarm system, whatever we have, our air horn, and we have someone approach from the parking lot. When the greeters see it, they sound the alarm, and we see how long it takes to close those doors, to secure them, see what options we have in there, and see what that looks like, versus everybody evacuating. What does that look like? Does the shooter eventually get to us? Does he find us in the back?
Oh, and then that's a confined area.
Exactly. You know, so that's what we need to do. And that's what really lacks in a lot of these environments, right? Everybody wants answers and everybody wants to know what the best thing to do is, but nobody wants to put the time in to get each building is going to be different. Everything's going to be different. The amount of people, what the layout is. So that would be my answer. I would like to see it. But based on what you're saying and what I'm seeing, those doors look like they're glass.
There's another set of doors closer to us. They're big wooden doors.
Oh, yeah, okay, I see them. And they'll shut that whole thing. Yeah. But my problem is somebody's going to have to come out and enter this open area to pull those shut, which, you know, may not be a bad thing unless, is there a release on those?
So, Officer, your first point about you coming out and watching us training and you evaluating is the absolute 100% answer. So for us to be able to demonstrate and say, no, you can't do this, we should do that. And actually, I think that's the best answer.
Okay, perfect.
We have taken one step. I don't know who knows those doors, but we have installed shatterproof.
On the outer door.
The question is, how do you lock if somebody's coming?
Well, that was my next thing. So if those are fire doors, they probably don't lock. Is that right?
How about the actual outside door?
Exterior.
Special glass we had installed recently, maybe two months ago.
It's just a Mylar.
Yeah.
Oh, Mylar.
Yeah, yeah. We talked about, did we put locks on the doors or no?
The locks on the doors on December 1st is the day when we start locking the doors during the service.
Okay.
That's a change that is in the works.
So the Mylar prevents a shooter from shooting the glass out, reaching in and opening the bar, which is what happened at the Sandy Hook Elementary shooting. There was a secure elementary school shot out the window of the door and entered. And so we want to prevent that. That's what the Mylar does. As far as the locks go, you know, that now makes the locks efficient. So if a greeter observes a threat, a gun in approaching the building, locks the doors, you have the Mylar in place, now we have time to progress to our next step of maybe securing different parts of the building and what our plan or evacuation would be. Did that answer your question, or were you going a different way with that?
No, I just wanted to make it. Yeah. We just have to figure out the protocol for securing the doors.
Right.
And it's still just a deterrent. It's not wooden doors like you're saying.
Right.
It would deter them for a period of time. That might
have
right.
Set 5 minutes for you to get here.
Yeah.
If you could just keep them.
Exactly. And you know, 3 to 5. The other thing is you're really close to our station.
Yeah.
So if anybody's at the station, they're coming. And that's quick.
Across the street.
They're not there though. So they come from home. I think we might have maybe one person. Matter of fact, they're actually talking about trying to be a full-time department where they'll actually house people in there 24 hours a day. Right now, it's not.
Like Adams Township.
Yes. Yes, correct. So
what is your protocol of training? I mean, you said you're a small department. Something happens. What happens on your end?
So what happens is everybody and their brother, mother, and sister is going to be coming from everywhere. Honestly, that's something that I'm working with my folks trying to hold one of the largest joint drills for active shooter that Pennsylvania has ever seen. I'm trying to coordinate that, but it's like pulling teeth trying to get everybody on board with that. But I would like to do a multi-service, multi-police department. The reality is there are a ton of people in Franklin Park that are government, county, state, local. We have police officers from all around that live here in Franklin Park. They all listen to their radio. They're coming. Everybody's coming. So you're going to have police from every Ohio Township, Cranberry Township, Economy Borough, McCandless, Ross, Northern Regional, Franklin Park, and they're all going to be coming. So it is going to be a spectacular display of power, which is both chaos and
panic,
concern, because we don't know what that looks like, right? The way we train is, as you approach, you just join teams. So as law enforcement, if I pull up and a McCandless guy pulls up, we're going in as a double. If I get here first, I'm coming in as a single. And I'm just going to start clearing and getting. And one thing you need to understand, when law enforcement get here, we're not worried about you as an individual. Our primary, and that's nothing personal, my job is to stop the threat. So if you're shot and wounded or hurt and you're asking me for help, I'm going to bypass you and continue on to look for the threat. That's why it's so important that I was telling you about those first aid kits, the training, because there has been multiple police officers who have retired who bypassed wounded people that were asking them for help that died, and they couldn't deal with it. I mean, they're in counseling, they left law enforcement altogether. It's just a terrible thing. But that is my priority. My priority is to stop the shooter, period. So, you know, that's what you can expect to see. You'll see law enforcement combing through this entire building en masse.
Have other churches who might be a little bit further down the road in this process have manuals already made, if you could point to and say, this is a really, really good one that helps us, so not everybody's recreating this?
So that's a really good question, and you'd be surprised. I'm probably up around 15 to 20 organizations that I've worked with through Franklin Park, and then even more through my company. Everybody moves at a different pace. Everybody's budget's different. Everybody wants something different. And I really can't seem to keep everybody consistent. It's odd. You would think that there would be, okay, step one, here it is. Step two, this is what it looks like. Step three, this is where we're trying to get to. But the truth is, people fall off along the way. Some people stick with it, other organizations fall off. I don't hear from them again. They don't have the money, they don't have the time, they lose interest, whatever the case may be. And so consistency is a problem. So if we were to stay consistent, we really could write the playbook for this.
I do have a couple of models. I'm not saying that they're good ones, I just collected a couple of models. There are a couple online, which I've done, one from Homeland Security, and then I also got the manual from Sewickley United Methodist, which was my model early on. So,
yeah, there's a lot of models that are out there, obviously, but the problem is they're generic kind of catch-alls. You have to plug your specifics into those models to make them work. And that's what we may or may not get to. So, yeah.
Can I ask a question?
Sure.
What is church policy of a crane and weapon in the church?
The church has a policy.
Yeah, and I think either when I was talking to you or when I was talking to the Allegheny County people who came around, I think they said that we actually can't ban firearms. People have a concealed carry permit and they bring them.
Yeah, I'm not real sure. I think if you, because it's private property, if you post a sign, but you have to post it, so it'd have to be on all your doors, your primary entrances, that you're not allowed. I believe you have that right, but I could be wrong. But I'm pretty sure you could ban weapons.
Some employer team ban weapons?
Yes. Yes, they do. Absolutely.
So would it be in our right as a private?
I think it would, but I think it's probably a legal issue that could be argued, honestly. But there has to be a law somewhere along. There has to be some kind of a black and white at some point. I'm not sure on that. But I know that there are organizations that outright ban firearms.
The VA, Cranberry.
Yeah.
And they've got a big sign right there. No guns, knives, weapons.
Yeah, hospitals have it. Like Children's North, they have things posted right up there on off Nicholson on 910. So it's out there.
What's the opinion from your perspective on safety? Would it make us more or less safe
to
prohibit weapons, firearms on site?
Very difficult question to answer because there's not a lot of data that I can review to give you a good answer. I would be guessing. It would be an opinion of mine. But to speak to both sides of it, when you go to a gunfight, your best weapon is to bring a gun to a gunfight. But the question then becomes, what is the training of the person with the gun? You know, how efficient are they with a weapon? Is this the person you want to have a weapon engaging the shooter? It's a difficult question, but if you were to ban guns, would it really stop anybody anyway? So in today's day and age, if you put a sign on that front door that says no weapons, are the concealed carriers going to obey anyway? I don't know the answer to that. And if you did post a sign, would the person who you wanted to have a gun then not, because they're a law-abiding citizen who's like, well, they posted it, so now I'm going to leave my gun at home, and now you've removed that from, you know, somebody who could really make a difference. Very difficult conversation. You know, again, there's just not a lot of data for me to pull and say, okay, well, in these examples, this was the outcome. It just hasn't happened yet. But that's an excellent question, and it's always a hot topic. Everybody wants the answer to that question.
And your answer is helpful, even though the data is.
Yeah, no, I appreciate it.
Would that be a, like if we would post something like that, that says no gun? Okay, so if you have a guy that's going to look for a place to shoot up, would that be a, more of a target for him then? Would that be no weapons or no gun?
I mean, it could play a factor, but I don't have anything to show that shooters are picking locations that are not banning weapons. So, you know, again, with churches, they're usually pretty specific. These are usually people of hate. They attack churches out of hate. So they're determined, and they have a plan, and they're coming, you know. So I don't know that they're necessarily going to care one way or another whether you ban people in the church to carry a gun. I don't know that that would deter them from carrying out an attack here. If you're targeted, there's going to be a reason you're targeted, and I don't think that would play a factor in it, personally. It could, but I would say probably not.
It's two-thirds. If there's one thing I'd like to have a reputation for, it's not keeping people beyond the post. Otherwise, you don't have people to come back.
Yeah.
So, Vinny, thank you very much. You give us a great starting point.
You're welcome.
I've got a lot of questions in the back of my head, and so ticking over crazily.
Good. Then I've succeeded.
Yeah.
As long as you're thinking, then I am happy. Really,
and
truly.
If you have to stick it, stay in touch going forward.
Yes.
Maybe do something like organize a drill down the road there.
I think it'd be very helpful.
All right.
Yep.
One last question.
Yeah.
A question. Comment. I'm like the friend of myself. I'm always watching you. Jason, you were just talking a minute ago. I've already called Franklin Park a number of times for what I call suspicious. And last time Jason's the officer showed up. And it's never anything. You know, it's either put something the wrong way, or they're going to fall asleep, or they drive by the hunch or slow, and pull in the driver, and pull back out. It happens to be that he comes up with his door. But Jason's always said, any place I've talked to, you see anything that you might think is suspicious, call us. And they've always been there immediately.
Yeah, you're not going to get scolded, or you're never wrong for reporting something. And after this training, you now have at least a baseline of what normal behavior is and what now is warning signs or red flags. So it's not like we're going to, you know, pull you in and scream at you, what are you doing, you idiot, for calling us for this stupid stuff? It's not going to happen. Not in today's day and age. It's not going to, I don't know that it ever happened. I can't speak on before my time, but that's not something that occurs. So don't ever hesitate to call if you're concerned, anywhere, even here, outside, etc. Don't hesitate, please. That's why we're training people. So thank you for this opportunity. I really appreciate it.